1990s were Michael Jordan's decade in the NBA. While he was winning 6 titles with the Bulls, 29 other organizations missed out on championship glory. These are the stories of some of the teams that were relegated to footnotes on MJ's path to the top. Today, the New York Knicks. They were kind of like the Bad Boy Pistons, but the Pistons didn't care at all about scoring points. They owned the second best winning percentage in the East throughout the 90s. And a team that was about 20 years removed from its previous last title back then, it's about another 25 years removed from that title now. Of course, we start with Patrick Ewing. Ewing entered the league in 1985 as the surest thing anyone could remember. So accomplished as a college player and dominant as a defensive center that Bill Russell comparisons seemed fair. If you look at Ewing's numbers and the Knicks' improvement while he was there, don't try to compare Ewing to anybody else when you do that. It's clear, the man delivered. Over the years, the Knicks added pieces around him. None were stars, but that was the charm of this unit. In 1988, the Knicks acquired Charles Oakley from the Bulls for Bill Cartwright. Jordan hated that trade because Oakley was one of his best friends, though Scottie Pippen probably liked it because Oakley once slapped him in the face on camera because Scottie was a rookie and Oak was Oak. In 1990, John Starks signed with the Knicks after an unnoteworthy year with the Warriors, followed by a year in the long-gone Continental Basketball Association. After the 1991 season, the Knicks signed Anthony Mason, a former college point guard turned power forward who played 24 games in the previous 2 seasons for the Pistons and Nuggets. All 3 would become New York basketball legends. While Jordan was winning his first title, Pat Riley wasn't even in the NBA. After 9 years of working with one prodigy, Magic Johnson, Riley spent the 1990-91 season working with another, Bob Costas at NBC. But May 31st, 1991, Riley signed a 5-year contract worth $1.5 million a year, the richest coaching contract in the NBA at the time, to replace John McLeod as head coach of the Knicks. Most fans remember Riley's Showtime Lakers for their dazzling up-and-down style, but the world didn't see his grueling practices and demanding approach that eventually burned out his players in Los Angeles. But in New York, the toughness was on full display. The toughness was the hallmark. It was what made them the Knicks. And if you don't believe it, over his 4-year tenure as Knicks head coach, the team led the entire NBA in personal fouls. The Knicks window didn't truly open until 1992, though only 2 teams at a time had legitimate windows in the East of the 1980s and early 90s. First it was the Sixers and Celtics, then Celtics and Pistons, then Pistons and Bulls, all of whom won a title in that stretch. But after Jordan and company dispatched the Bad Boys in 1991, the next true contender played at Madison Square Garden. And until Riley left New York in 1995, winning the East meant you might want to beat the Knicks. In Riley's first season coaching the Knicks, they finished 2nd in the NBA in defensive rating before leading the league the next 3 seasons. From 92 to 95, the Knicks won 50 games each season, including seasons of 57 and 60 wins. Only once prior had the Knicks won 57 games, and only once prior had they won 60 games. In both of those seasons, they won championships. The Knicks were a bunch of starter from the bottom stories. Even Ewing to some extent. Sure, he looked like a Hall of Fame center, but there weren't many great basketball players coming out of Jamaica at that time. Then there were Oakley and Mason, 2 undersized power forwards who attended historically black colleges who were perfectly relatable to anyone who's played pickup basketball. It was well over skill with those 2, making them heroes to a generation of guys who love playing basketball in spite of not being that good at it. Nothing says what Pat Riley was going for quite like signing Anthony Mason and Xavier McDaniel, 2 6'7" power forwards in the same offseason. I mean, just look at these dudes. And then there was John Starks, who was maybe 6'3", not particularly good at one particular thing, but man, he went hard. And that right there was the New York Knicks. If you like guys who gave it everything they had, this was the team for you. But depending on how you liked your basketball in 1992, there's a chance you hated every single player on this team. Say what you want about the Bad Boy Pistons, but they had excellent offensive players that were fun to watch. Zeke, Joe Dumars, Vinny the Microwave Johnson, owner of the greatest nickname in NBA history. But the Knicks, they came to beat the hell out of you. They even had guys who wanted to beat the hell out of you when they were on the injured list and seated on the bench wearing the most 1993 shirt of all time. Clyde Frazier might say Greg Anthony was thuggin' and Republican. In the Riley era, the Knicks were between mediocre and bad on offense and bottom 5 in the league in pace every season. The sludge of late 90s NBA offense, so bad the league has spent 20 years making sure that doesn't happen again, starts right here, when Pat Riley showed the world that a team could get itself 1 win away from beating Jordan's Bulls and 1 game away from winning a championship in 1994 on sheer physicality. even if you appreciate it, you'd hate it if someone tried to make you watch it now. The dunk. It isn't the greatest dunk of all time. It might not even be the best baseline dunk at MSG during the 90s. Look at that one Jordan did. But it is John Starks with the Knicks up by three, under a minute left, hoping to take a commanding 2-0 lead over the Bulls with the left hand off two legs over Horace Grant with Jordan close enough to make the poster. And I seen the poster because the dude in my dorm freshman year had it, and Jordan's right there in it. Not once since then have the Knicks felt so close to a title. Oh, and let's not forget Derek Harper and JoJo English fighting in David Stern's lap in Game 3 of the 1994 East Semis. Same game where Scotty sat out the final possession because they didn't call it a play for him.
That is right below the commissioner who is sitting in the third row here.
Whew. What did Mike do to the Knicks? In the Riley era, including playoffs, the Bulls with Jordan were 28-11 against the Knicks. And it started before Riley got there as the Bulls bounced the Knicks from the playoffs in 91, and 92, and 93, and 96 for good measure. And it was all different kinds of misery. A sweep in 91, a grueling seven-game Bulls triumph in 92, and the disappointment of that 2-0 lead and losing four straight in 93. In the particulars,
54 points.
Then Mike came back to the league after retirement in 95, looked rusty for a couple games, put up double nickel at MSG. Poor Patrick Ewing. He was on the business end of Jordan's game-winning shot in the 1982 NCAA championship game, then got eliminated by MJ five times in the playoffs in the 90s, more than any other Hall of Famer during that span. Well, Charles Smith. Here's Charles Smith, Game 5, 1993.
Stop Smith! Stop Smith! Stop the game by Pippen! What a play by Scottie Pippen!
Anyway, on October 6, 1993, Jordan stunned the world and announced his retirement. It was a sad day for the NBA, but the best news the Knicks ever heard, the East was theirs. And in 93-94, the Knicks had the most wins in the East, finally conquered the Bulls, with a little help from Hugh Hollins, weathered a challenge from Reggie Miller and the Pacers, and made the NBA Finals to face the Rockets. After five games, the Knicks led 3-2, heading to Houston with two chances to close it out. The Knicks spent the second half of Game 6 chipping away at a 10-point halftime deficit, but despite John Starks' 27 points, lost 86-84. 3 days later in Game 7, let's just say Starks didn't score 27 points. Brick after brick after brick after brick. Starks went 2-for-18 from the floor. The Knicks lost Game 7, 90-84. And the way we talk about Hakeem Olajuwon, well, it ain't the way we talk about Patrick Ewing. By 95, there wasn't much left. Ewing didn't have enough left in his legs to make a finger roll in Game 7 to stave off elimination from the Pacers. Riley resigned via fax at season's end. That was that. The most 90s team of the 90s, with a Hall of Fame star, coached by a legend who won 8 titles as a player, coach, and executive at his other stops, couldn't get it done in New York on Michael Jordan's watch. Well, the Knicks couldn't do it any other time, but, you know, you get the point.
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.